Hello everyone, good evening. It's a pleasure to be amongst friends. I see everyone I know so very well, and I wish we could meet in person, but I'm happy that we can at least connect online. So I'm going to keep it simple in the interest of time, as well as the fact that I'm mostly speaking to people who already practice this. So my topic is filler indications and safety. So what I'm going to touch upon is basically talking a little bit about brow volume, then the tear trough, and a word on safety. So keeping it very simple, whenever we talk about brow volume, for someone who is not into it really, can get confused as to which volume we are talking about. So this is an intraoperative photograph which is showing the orbital fat, which is limited by the orbital rim, and beyond the rim you have this subbrow fat, and this is the fat we are talking about in order to volumize whenever we speak of volume within the brow region. So here is an example where you see a fold of skin, and obviously to a novice eye this would look like a case for blepharoplasty, but what has happened here is that the brow has deflated. The convex forward anatomy of the brow has become sort of flat or deflated, and that is the reason why excess of skin is visible. All we need is to fill it up. So you could do that either with a filler or fat, and you would get that convexity. Not only would you get the convexity, but the fold of skin would disappear. So here's a video. This is obviously done for a reason of enophthalmos in a patient who was also undergoing a filler into the orbit. But here I'm showing the technique of injecting the brow area. So you are outside the orbital rim. You are within the retro orbicularis oculi fat, and as I go more medially, where you're likely to hit vessels, I am aspirating before I inject. So injecting deep, just above the periosteum, to get the desired contour is what we are trying to achieve here. So this is the example I already showed you. Here is another lady where we haven't done anything to the eyelid surgically. It's just the brow volume which has been made convex apart from other injections such as the temple. So you can see the fold disappearing with the filler injection. Tear trough, we all do this procedure. As I have evolved with this, I have learned that earlier when I was sort of new to this technique, I used to go right into the depth of the tear trough and inject there. And it never really gave me any natural results. But now I stick to more towards the thicker part, which is towards the cheek, and not go towards the eyeball. And that is what really gives me the desired contours. It also looks more natural. And mind you, it's not always that you find bone beneath this area. So considering bone as your guideline to inject it deep may not always work. It may work in a majority of cases, but there are some where you are actually injecting over the orbital opening as such. So, injecting more towards the cheek and to raise that thicker skinned cheek anatomy higher up into the tear trough is what I find more useful. It also reduces the number of bumps that I get in this procedure. So, you can either do these for the young who want to get rid of their tear trough, as you can see here. This is a classic example of how, if you just fill in this area more than the actual bed of the tear trough, you get a good reduction, and it also sort of improves that tired look. On the left side, there was a little bit of overcorrection which we had to dissolve. Here is another example, and one more, and another one. Apart from the fillers, there was also some peel required through my dermatology friend for this particular patch of hyperpigmentation. So the point is to inject it deep, but also to inject more closer to the cheek anatomy. And talking about safety, I am not really none of us are really concerned about bruises, and we always explain this to the patient. But what worries us all is the blindness issue. And this is not only applicable to fillers, but also to fat and even triamcinolone that we inject. And if we were to revise the anatomy as to why this happens, it's basically the filler going reverse direction through one of these branches, if at all your needle happens to be in the artery. So it goes backwards, reverse flow into the ophthalmic, and then somehow comes anteriorly to lodge into the central retinal artery. So there's been a lot of research on this topic. People have tried to use retrobulbar hyaluronidase. There have been studies on animal models. Adit was very actively involved in these. People have tried to see whether hyaluronidase can penetrate the sheath of the optic nerve, because that's where most of your vessel is lying, where you want to dissolve that filler particulate matter. But we are far from a good solution as yet. So any research in this area is definitely going to be very relieving for all of us out there who do fillers day in and day out. So just a quick recap. Brow volume is sometimes a bleph saver, and you have to think about it before you plan the blepharoplasty. There can be cases where you do a bleph and intra-op, you decide to inject fat into the brow area, and that's a combination which is possible. Tear trough, prefer to inject deep, and also on the cheek side of the anatomy. That's my personal experience. And with regards to safety, we all are concerned about blindness, for which a finer needle, maybe shifting to a cannula, using vasoconstriction of any form, such as application of ice, would help us in minimizing this complication, as well as injecting very slow, aspirating prior to the injection.